Live from the Mobian stage in sunny Burbank. I've said it before, I'll say it again. What a time to be alive. Paul Gabory, I'm Louis Tucci here on behalf of Maxon ZBrush with our 2022 ZBrush Summit. I got Paul Gabory to my left. Paul, the presentations today have had one thing in common. They've been electric and eclectic. How are you feeling?
And that's a moment with Louis. Okay.
Put your little tag thing.
Yeah, I'm going to make one. I swear, probably it's going to happen.
What was the highlight for you? The last one we just saw.
The highlight. Listen, I thought they all did a great job. All three of them. I know a lot of the people in the chat really enjoyed the breaking down of how they were doing stuff. So I think that was the highlight overall, how they broke down what they were working on.
Very succinct.
So people could really understand how they were using ZBrush for their particular workflow in their pipeline.
You know, speaking of workflows, one thing that I can say with great certainty is that the next guest has changed and transformed many a workflow across the globe. You're nodding yes with this at this point, yes? Paul is nodding emphatically yes. The next up, we're going to be bringing to our stage a guy who has had an impact on your work, whether or not you know him or not. Damien Kanderley has dubiously created the damn standard brush, and I think we can all thank him very, very much from the bottom of our hearts. He's going to be joining us here on the Mobian stage, and I know that there's a Damien standard too, which is a damn standard too. What's better than damn once?
Now you can ask him. He's here. It's like whack-a-whack-a.
We're going to do it.
Some people.
So without further ado, let's run the tape and bring him online with myself and Paul Gabory here at the ZBrush Summit 2022. Stay tuned and sit tight. We're going to bring him on the stage. Ashanti Bolshear, here we go. Welcome to the stage again. How are you?
I'm fine.
How are you?
Great.
Good.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm scared, as always. It's always difficult to make presentation like that, but
nothing to be afraid of.
So glad to be here.
Okay, so the first question, obviously.
Go ahead. You've been waiting, since yesterday for this.
A lot of people want to know, it's damn standard, right?
Or Dame Standard?
Dame Standard.
What do you prefer?
Dame, how do you want to say it?
Dame Standard's fine.
Dame Standard. Okay, so now we know.
Dame Standard.
Dame Standard. Damien.
I always say his full name. I always say the Damien.
I call it Dame because Dame.
So many people
use it.
People say Damien because it's not writing in the name.
I know. That's probably my fault. I'm not going to lie. That's probably my fault. Because I usually do say your name when I highlight that brush.
Oh, okay.
I let people know, hey, this is made by Damien Kanderley, who made this brush. It's one of the most popular brushes in ZBrush. It also helps me understand, to show people, look, you can make a custom brush, and you never
good
know.
Good point.
Right?
There's
very
so many
point.
Great brushes you can find online. It's crazy.
But you also added to the collection of Dame 1. You've got Dame 2.
Yeah, exactly. Not many people used it because it's a bit different. It's not as broad on the usage, but it's very useful. Maybe I can show it later today.
Yeah, well, I hope so. And you've been busy. You've been a busy guy. You've been working with, obviously, historically, you worked with Blur, but now more recently with Netflix and Love, Death, and Robots.
Yeah, actually, I'm still working at Blur for this show, but yes.
Yeah, so it's a conjunction of that. It sees you expanding the horizons and doing some more animation-based type work.
And you've worked on all the seasons, right? You've done all the seasons?
I worked on both, yes.
Yeah.
The first, second, and third.
Yeah.
And hopefully the fourth.
Well, listen,
it's pretty popular. I see them continuing it on. It's one of their popular
incredible
IPs for sure.
Incredible stuff.
Yeah. What I think it is, it's the different shows. I think why people really like it. It's a different.
It's very episode. Different, yes. I'm going to speak a bit about it in my presentation, but yes, it's. I think what is very great with this project, it's every episode is different.
Yeah.
Every episode has its own style, its own story, and you can enjoy it, you can't, sometimes you won't, but in the end you have a lot of stuff to see and very different stuff, and it's what I like on this show.
Yeah, I think so too. I think there's that dynamic quality to the work that is allows a lot of people to get into different styles and be exposed to different things. But without further ado, I want to thank you on behalf of everybody on our team for your contributions through the years and for participating again with us here at the ZBrush Summit 2022. I say hand off the conch to you and take it away and show us a little bit about what you came to talk about.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Yeah.
So first, I want also to thank you to have me again on the presentation. It's an honor for me to be here. So I hope this presentation will be useful to people. What I'm going to show you. Wait, where is it? Today.
Okay. And once again, people, I'll be monitoring the chat, throwing questions where I can to Damien.
Yeah, don't hesitate to participate. We're here with you live until the end.
Yeah, feel free to ask questions during the presentation. And so, Paul, I'm sure you will do it fine.
Don't
ask me anything. So, Love, Death and Robot. What is Love, Death and Robot? Basically, it's an animated series on Netflix. As we told just before, it's a different episode with each episode has its own story. And what is very interesting is that each episode also has its own style. The main project was created by Tim Miller. Tim Miller is the man who created Blur Studio a few years ago. And if you don't know Blur Studio, basically it's a studio that was created at first mainly to create some cinematic and game trailer in the video game industry. And over the years, we're starting to produce more content creation like Netflix, and also working on some movie like Deadpool or Terminator, Last Terminator. Maybe we can play the trailer of Love, Death
and Robot. Absolutely, that would be great. We can definitely play the trailer.
I don't know if it's
really... Bobby, hit the music.
If it's not, I will play it on my side.
Yeah, let's see in the back. Do we have the ability to play the video from you guys in the back?
People in the control truck. We got them.
Control truck?
Yeah, we got the... Let's get
okay, they're going to play it for him.
If you awaken from this illusion, and you understand that black implies white, life implies death, you can feel yourself, not as a stranger in the world, but you can begin to feel your own existence, what you are basically. Is the fabric and structure of existence itself. The universe is a celebration. It's a fireworks show to celebrate that existence is. Everybody is fundamentally the ultimate reality. Only you're pretending you're not.
Yeah, we're not very loud.
No, that was not very loud. Clap if I ever saw.
Kind of it's great.
We need a little fake clap button.
Yes. Yeah.
A little golf clap, please.
Well, so everyone clap. Okay.
just two guys. Here.
Okay. So my role on Love, Death and Robot, my part, I was very lucky to be able to work on 6 different episodes. On the main season, on the first season, I mean, I worked on Sony's Edge, and also a bit on Shapeshifter.
On
the second one, I work on Pop Squad, mainly this one, and on Life Hutch. And on the last one, I work a bit on Swarm, but mostly on Bad Traveling on the characters. It's what I'm going to show you in a bit.
Louis, isn't that your favorite film? Didn't you say
just,
I can't wait.
Before I'm going to Bad Traveling, the first episode I worked on Love, Death and Robot, actually it was one of my favorite because I really like the style and stuff like that. But what was very important on this episode, it's basically the episode where I started to create this workflow I'm going to present to you today.
Very nice.
So
we like
this
it.
One is very stylized. The one I'm the Bad Traveling is a bit more realistic, a bit more dark also in the style, but the process is pretty much the same. So about traveling, just to give a few info about the context, it's the episode where a crew on a ship get attacked by a huge crab monster, and this crab taking home inside the ship. And we follow the story where the crew member try to survive this crab. It's a kind of a very dark story. It was directed by David Fincher, which also is why it's kind of darker. And it was really great because there are really a vision on the story. When you have a good director, it's not just trying to do some images on animated. There's really a vision on the full project. And I think it's also why this episode is working so much, so great. Basically, what I'm going to show you today, it's my workflow for this phase. References, I will talk first about references because I think this is something very important. And most of the time, people don't spend enough time on this part of the project. Then I will move to ZBrush. Speaking about the first step, the blocking step. The blocking, for me, it's the most important step because basically it's just trying to get the main shape, the overall proportion and stuff like that, but not going into details at this stage. Why it is very important? It's because if you don't have good blocking at this stage, whatever you are going to do after that, it doesn't matter. Your character won't work because the main element of the details of the proportion and stuff like that won't be there.
So glad to hear you say that. This has been the message all day long
from
the very beginning. We were talking about anatomical construction and physiological makeup and the power and dexterity it can provide for design.
Yeah, I guess it's a very basic notion, but most of the time when you see stuff on internet, you see that people are liking this tape. And it's too bad because you see some great modeling, some great stuff. The rendering is awesome. But since the main shape, the main blocking wasn't done correctly, it's not the very top of the...
Yeah. And your guy looks like, if we call him back up on the screen there, we have your model that you have as a reference here as you're speaking about it, looks like a prize fighter from the 1920s and 30s in boxing.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
So second stage is the secondary shapes. So basically, it's just adding more details, a bit finer. I will also speak about topology and stuff like that. And finally, the tertiary shape and fine details. It's what really gives some really fine wrinkles, some grain and stuff like that. So maybe I can show you the DAM standard 2 in this case.
Absolutely, thank you.
Okay.
It would be a joy.
And
pleasure.
If I got some time, maybe a bit about polypaint. Okay, so just before moving to ZBrush, I spoke about references.
Oh, look at this.
Why it is very important. The way I'm working when using references, I'm using PureRef. If you don't know this soft, it's very awesome. You can get it for free, but feel free to donate or contribute to the project because for references, it's the best software.
Say the name one more time.
PureRef. You should pray.
PureRef.
PureRef is very popular.
PureRef is a very popular format.
Very popular.
Basically, you can grab and drop images from everywhere into a single file, and you can organize everything. So I won't do the promotion of this, but it's awesome. So basically, what I'm doing is putting all my references. So this is a concept art I got from Blur to start working on my character. So concept for the full body, concept for the head. So here, I put all the concepts of all the crew members in order to always have in mind what will be the full cast. Because if I'm starting working on only this face, and somebody is working on only another one, and you don't have you don't see all the face all together, you can start to go into one direction, another person go into another direction, and at the end, when you're putting every one together, it won't work well.
They won't look like they've been on the same ship.
Yeah, exactly. So it's why I like to get a reference of all the characters of the show. And after that, it's just mainly putting together a reference from different aspects of the character. For instance, here, It's a references for the clothes. Same here for the jacket and stuff like that. Here, more important, it's about the body and the face. So trying to find some nice references for the body.
Hey, it's Iggy Pop.
Yes, we knew that the body of Turin, which is here, here, was kind of very tall but very skinny, even if the proportions are stylized. We wanted to go for a realistic look at the end. So I think Iggy Pop kind of is a good match for this kind of character.
Yeah, it's a good model for anything, Iggy Pop.
Yeah.
In many ways, you know.
For anatomic, it's perfect.
I want to be a dog.
Yes, and yeah, basically, that's it. I had another one for specific faces, but I forget to bring it today, so.
Admit nothing, Damien, admit nothing.
Okay, so.
Not here by omission.
So that's it for the reference, but I can't stress it enough. References are very, very important. Don't start a project without good references.
Let's pause there and tell the people at home again, don't start anything without reference. You're only as good as your reference. Paul Gabriel is nodding yes and grinning ear to ear again, giving a nod of approval.
It is. Then I think it puts your mindset into the piece that you're making.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, like,
you know what I say?
I go over the board sometimes, honestly, with my references.
You know what I say?
Yeah.
I tell the students all the time, I say, it's like asking yourself, I want to go to the store. Which store do you want to go to? If I just tell you I want to go to the store, I'd be driving around all day looking for nothing. Let's know where we're going to go. Right back over to you.
Exactly. So, first step.
That's a moment with Louis. Is what that was right there, Dan. Welcome to it.
You got to know which store you're going to. This store, in this case, we're going to the ZBrush. Take it away.
Let's go.
This is your custom UI.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes. And actually, you don't see everything because this screen for the streaming is a lot smaller than mine. Basically, I have all kind of stuff everywhere. Yeah. Same here. I have more stuff here. And same if I'm...
I like you're going with the old school gray from ZBrush 2.0.
It's maybe because I'm so old myself. And
I'm not that young. It's reminding me of that. It's reminding me of the old ZBrush.
Let's not age ourselves here, people. Let's not age ourselves.
The ridge.
Yeah.
Holding on to my youth, one lock at a time.
Okay, let's go. So just before starting, I will show you some tips when I'm working on this stage. So as I said, this stage is just making the blocking of the character, or the worst character, it will be red, with very simple shapes and not going into details. In order to manage to not going into details, I will work with very low resolution. So I will start whatever, with a sphere, with a cylinder or whatever. It don't really matter. I will just smooth it a bit with subdivision. And pretty much right away, I will go to Dynamesh. And and this is not enough. But I won't go very, very high in resolution. Oops. What happened?
Is that switching to Dynamesh?
For some reason, no.
Try loading that cylinder again, just.
I will try again. Up.
Yep.
No, it. Oh my.
Oh, there it is. You're in Dynamesh mode now.
Oh, yes. Okay. So, as I said, I don't want to go into crazy resolution. Okay, maybe something like that. Because if I have too much resolution, first, I will go to details too quickly. And second, I will lose focus on the main shapes. So it's why I don't want to go very high resolution. So that is the first important stuff. I will go symmetry. And I will basically start sculpting my character. So for this stage, I'm basically using clay buildup, smoothing, and move tool also quite a lot.
How about the Dame Standard Brush?
Not that much at this stage, but yes, sometimes, yes, I do, when I want to do some stuff.
You've been
like
waiting
that.
For that one for a while.
Oh, that was locked and loaded right when you walked in the building, brother.
Just increase the strength.
Okay. That's a classic approach you have, you know? I really wanted to tell you that. I always like watching your work.
Yeah, it's why when I'm working on this kind of project, actually, I never start. Because we have a base mail head at Blur, and most studio also have some base topology to use. But I don't start from that, because I find that when you're starting from head that is already kind of shaped, you kind of lock on this head, the proportions, the size of the eyes, the mouth, the ear, everything. It's hard to get away from this.
It's so preconceived, right?
Yes, it's why I think it's better to start from nothing.
Same, me too. Use a sphere.
So, okay, like this. So it's very basic. It's just a sculpting, trying to get the shapes and everything together. I won't spend a lot of time on this kind of stuff because it's I find it really... I enjoyed this part of the process because it's where it really starts from nothing and you bring your character to life. But I'm not sure it's very interesting to watch for you. And actually, it's kind of very straightforward, so you won't learn much from this process. But I'm going to show you a few tips, and this will be more useful for you. Just okay. So. Few tips that I can give you when you're working on this process. First of all, what is very important, it's switching matcap very often. Or if you're using basic material, what I have in my UI just here, it's the light. Because it's very important to be able to see your character with different lighting situation. Because if you're working only with one situation, It will look fine, it will look great, okay, you're happy with it, but as soon as you export your model into a render engine with correct lighting and everything, it won't look as good. If you make the process of trying to watch in different angle with the light, you can understand better the shapes and it will be better in the end. So this is basically my first tips. For this
sound
stage.
Advice, you start that early. I'm amazed that you do that so early.
And another one, I'm a very, very, very big fan of the morph target. I'm using the morph target all the time, and especially at this stage. Most people use the morph target, including myself, later in the process when you add details, and when you don't want the details everywhere, you can kind of erase the details with the morph brush. I will show also that soon.
Do you always start with a cylinder for a face? Or is that something you always do, is with a cylinder?
Sorry?
Do you always start with a cylinder when you're doing a face, or?
Yeah, because it's always there.
Oh, yeah?
I think it doesn't matter because you move stuff on the...
Well played, monsieur, well played. Right.
So I'm going to use the morph target, as I said. So basically, I store my morph target. I will just smooth this like that. Going for the ear. Okay, so just working, let's say 10, 15 minutes on your character. Then it's when you can switch back to what you had before. And what I like in this process, it's you can see it's very early stage, so it's not so obvious. But sometimes when you're working too long on a character, you think you did something very awesome, and when you switch back to your previous version, you actually realize your previous version was better. Because when you're too focused on your character, you just lose track of what you're doing and lose track on the shapes. And it's good sometimes to refresh your eyes. And I think the Morph Brush, Morph Target, is the best way to refresh your eye. So the way I'm working, it's I put an Alt key on the switch. So I can easily just try to see if what I did is good or not. For instance, here, well, basically it was a very early project, so most of it is better, but I kind of like the shape of this part of the mouth. So I will I don't have my hotkeys, so that's okay. I will go back to the morph. Okay. And I will just bring back this part of the model that I feel work much better. Okay, maybe a bit too high on this part. Yes, basically that's the way I'm using the morph target at this stage. Another thing, I don't think many people know these tips. When I'm working on this stage, I'm usually working with, it didn't escape. Okay. I'm usually working with a clay tube. And what I like to do, kind of like a traditional clay, I also like to remove stuff, but sometimes I want to make some stuff planar. Oh, you can use the smooth brush, but I don't like the way the smooth brush works at this stage because basically it's smoothing, so it's great, but I don't want this. I think my keyboard. I don't have undo. I'm going to work without undo. What I'm going to do instead of using the regular smooth, you can, when you hold the shift key to activate the smooth, you can actually pick another brush instead of the smooth brush. So the way I'm working, it's using a flattened one, and that way I can just add some clay tube, and at the same time I can flatten the shapes. And working that way, it allows me to get some very planar shapes quite easily. Like that. Up, flatten. And I find that in the end, you can get some very sharp results, some very interesting results, much quicker than with a smooth.
Okay. Yeah, very painterly quality to the way that you illustrate this, you know? It's very nice.
Yeah, I like the, I would say the traditional feeling you can get with ZBrush.
Yeah, me too.
And it's also why I said I prefer to start from nothing, because I like this part of the process. For me, it's the most interesting part of the process. So if I'm starting from something that's already there, I'm feeling I'm missing something. Okay, so basically not very interesting, but it was to show you some tips. Last tips I can show you on this part of the process. When it's more related when you're looking to match some references, you can use the spotlight. Spotlight basically allow you to bring some images into that brush interface. And the way I'm using it, it's, where is the textures? I'm going to load my spotlight. So here. I think I switch the keyboard to. I switch to English keyboard. So. The way I'm working, it's putting some references into my viewport, just turning down the opacity. It's a pretty regular workflow so far. But when I have that, also you can use this in combination with a camera. Here, I will show you this. Yeah, so you can just put your face here. Up. You can store the camera. I will say side. You put this one here, oops, like that. Up. I will store another one front. Oops. And last one here. Up. And I will also store, I will call it third, doesn't matter. And now that I have all my camera stored, I can still work here just like I want. Just try to improve my model. But I can always switch back to all my view. So it's kind of a nice setup to just trying to match your main proportions, in this case, this character. Up, trying to match the side. See how it looks in third view. Up, front, and so on, and so on. So, I find it's a very useful to use this kind of tools. And the last tool I'm using at this stage, it's actually not a tool. It's not made for this anyway. But it's the same, always in the same workflow and mind flow. To work only on broad details and not going in broad shapes, not going into details. There are actually, you can half the size of the viewport. It's the anti-aliasing. And I'm using this actually to get my viewport smaller. And it's forced me to work only on the main shape. Because if I have my full viewport, I will often try to go into details like that. And it's not something I want to do at this stage. So if I have this like this, I won't be able to zoom as much on the screen. So it's why I like to use both of them.
So you're putting yourself kind of in a little box to just keep your focus where you
exactly.
need to be.
Exactly. It's like when you do drawing, traditional drawing, what you can do from time to time, it's trying to blur your vision
right.
to get only the main shapes. Basically, it's kind of this idea, to see the model smaller in order to only see the main shapes.
I think it's great, yeah.
So basically, that's it for this stage. Oh, it's absolutely awful what I did. I'm kind of ashamed of this.
No, stop.
But, it wasn't the point wasn't to do something very nice.
It's actually already starting to fit with the film. Like
yeah,
it's looking
c'est magnifique.
That direction.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
You might not have been trying to do it, but it started looking like it was gonna fit with the film.
Yeah.
I felt like it.
Yeah.
You're too kind.
Yeah. Oh stop, here we go.
So basically
you press the button and here we are.
Yes. You see?
Just like that. One button.
Just switch the morph target and
the power
boom,
of
you are. So I would say this is my first stage that I push a bit more, and I'm kind of happy with the overall proportion. It's now the time where I will need to go to the second stage, to start to go to secondary details, but also it's at this stage that I will need to get proper topology. Currently, it's something that is dynamic, and what I want now is to get to get this topology It's actually the topology we are using. I need this topology exactly because it's set up correctly with rigging animation, facial animation, blend shape, and all kind of stuff that we are going to reuse on this character to make the process of animating and everything faster.
This is the head used in studio.
Yes, exactly.
Right, across the whole pipeline.
Every studio got its own topology, own shapes, but basically this is the one we are using. So the way I'm going to do this, I'm going to hide the hair because I don't need this. I'm going to add this one up, and I'm going to turn the ghost in order to see only my my good topology, and it will be a very simple process, just moving the topology. Pretty much at the right place. So there is some part that is always tricky. The ears are very tricky to do. So from this, sometime I won't do projection on the ear. The eyes also is very tricky. I will show you some tips I'm using on the eyes part. The mouth, trying to get clove.
You're really trying to shove it all in there.
Oops.
Right.
I won't do the full process because I'm short on time, but basically that's the way I'm doing it. I'm going to go back to the smooth. I will store a morph target and I will project. Yes. So basically sometime I will get this kind of artifact. It's because the distance of the morph target isn't high enough. So basically, I can tweak the distance, okay, or the way I'm doing it most of the time, it's just using a clay brush to bring back the model closer to my reference. I will go back, okay. And it's kind of an iterative process. You start at the main place on just, or here, I'm not actually good. Like this, project, smooth, project. Bring it back. And since I'm working with the ghost for the other subtool, I can know just by looking at my model, if I have dark area, it's because my current model is under the model I'm going to project. If I don't have the dark part, it's because I'm over the model I want to project to. So it's easy to me to know if I have to just add or remove to push or, I don't find my word. But I think you get the idea.
To match the underline, to match the surface.
Yes, exactly.
Form, detail.
Like this, up. And now if I'm doing a project, it will be better.
So is it poly-painted red, or you got polygroup on right now? You have poly, so, polyframe on. Do you have polyframe on now?
Yes, I have polyframe, okay. Yes.
So that way you can see the red.
Yeah, I see the red, but also I see the, why I'm doing actually, it's a good point. Why I'm doing with polyframe, it's because I want to see the topology. Because what I don't want to do is this kind of stuff.
Stretch it.
On the project, and I have something that I can't work with. I really want to have a nice flow in the topology. And, okay, like this. So basically, this is the main process. So you have to do it, to take time to go all over your model and make sure everything is working fine. We also have something that we call keyline at Blur, but I know the studio are working the same. Basically, it's a map, it's a 2D map that I'm going to show you here. Oops. Yeah, you can see this 2D map. It's a texture that gives you the main keys of the face. It's very important in order to be able to translate blend shape and morph target from one shape, from one head to the other, even if the heads are very different in size, proportion, style, or everything. So it's a very
important. Can you turn off the other subtools so they can see a good look at that map? The transparent, yeah, there you go. So they can see. So you're highlighting the major important movement, in essence, of a human face.
Yes, and it's very important. So you know that the lips will always be there. It's very important, not only for animation, but it's also very important if you want to make some maps or to share some maps from one character to the other. Because that way you know that the lips will always be correct on your maps. So you can share it very easily between characters.
Does it help to define the edge flow there too?
Actually, no, because the edge flow was defined before that.
Right, okay, good.
But what is important to bring it there, it's I know where I can put exactly my line. And I know that this line, I want it here.
It's a great tip. This is a fantastic tip. This day's just chocked full of it.
Doing this for free here, I can't believe it. All you have to do is log in.
This is a bigger tip than you think, Damien. This is a fantastic idea.
Oh.
For everybody.
So here, like that. Then for the lips, for instance, so I didn't get very nice on the lips, on the projection, but basically, it's just trying to find the right place, and then I can reproject it. I can smooth this from time to time to make sure everything is working together, and reproject, and so on, and so on. Okay, as I said, I won't do the full character. I'm short on time, but hopefully you get the idea. Oops. And pretty much what we are going to get at the end of this process is a nice topology over your characters, and then you will be able to move further into the process. So I think I have this here, if I'm not, yes. So basically, this is what I'm going to get at the end. Or maybe not exactly this one, because I've sculpted a bit more on this one, but this is what I'm going to get. Just a quick tips on the eyes. The eyelid is always something that is tricky because it's very thin, and usually when you start to add details and stuff like that, you're losing that sharpness. You want a bit of sharpness on the eyelid, but most of the time when you're sculpting it, you're losing it. What you can use, what I'm using at, anyway, it's the smooth polygroup. By default, the smooth group basically will smooth the transition between two subtool polygroup. Basically, if I'm doing, I don't have my hotkey. What is W?
Control W.
What are you looking for?
Yeah, but I'm in English on a French keyboard, so.
I'll invert it back to you on you. What hotkey are you looking for?
I think it's a Control W.
Yeah, Control W.
But
it's not working for you? You're trying to group that piece that you're masking, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Control W.
But it's. I don't know how to switch to French.
Select with the Control Shift and just.
You just want to make a new
make
polygroup?
A selection.
I would just go to Tool Polygroup if the shortcut's not working and Group Visible.
He meant to just make the mask part. He's trying to mask. He's trying to polygroup the mask part.
Groups by mask.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, it will be easier that way. The group, the smooth group, what is going to do,
But you've got spotlight on.
Shift Z.
You need to turn off the projection of spotlight.
Shift Z. Yeah. There you go.
Yes, this is going to do this. So it's very useful when you're working with eyelid, because I can make some polygroup on my eyelid, and I can also make another one like this. like this. Oh. Group visible. Yeah. And now I can just go into subdivision. I will hide everything. And when I'm going to smooth, I will get some very sharp result. So this is very interesting to make sure you have some sharp stuff going on. That's and great. For the lead, it's very useful. That way, I'm sure to have some very nice sharp shapes. And when I'm done, when I've got my sharp shapes that I can move easily now, and then I will just go to regular smoothing and just smooth away all the very sharp angle.
So, man, that's cool. Am I glad I woke up this morning?
So you're using the poly groups in order to add stylistic portion.
Exactly.
Yep.
Because it's what I like with this.
Yeah.
Actually, it's also when you're doing this. If I'm taking only this with this one, it's an easy way to make it this very sharp, very smooth. You can also, if you want, just use the flatten on this part. And just with a smooth group, you will always keep this very sharp angle.
Yeah, yeah.
And I also can do it for the lips. And
another great tip here.
It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
I'm really short. Totally off time.
Keep going.
Okay, basically, that's it for the, I will say, for the secondary details. Mm-hmm. It was a technical part of the secondary details. What I'm doing, also, it's of course going into subdivision. I'm doing some finer stuff like that. Basically, the same process. Nothing fancy. Nothing new here. Just in order to get something a bit more interesting. So last step for the modeling part, it's bringing the very fine detail. I will keep working on this one. For the very sharp details on this character, since I knew that I was going to add a lot of close-up on the face, and the episode was long in time, I needed to add a very high resolution on the model. So the basic way I'm working usually is just to subdivide the mesh several times until I have enough resolution. But with only one mesh, when working with ZBrush, basically working with too many subdivisions, at the end it will be very, very slow, almost unable to work with this. So I choose to use Geometry HD. Geometry HD basically lets you go higher into subdivision, but just working on some parts. So it's something that you can find a lot of tutorial. I don't want to spend much time on this, but just to let you know that I work with Geometry HD. I will show you this. So basically, if I'm going there, this is the model without Geometry HD, where you see all the fine details and everything. And if you're going on your model like this, Shift A, then you can dig into very, very small details. And this is where you can really add grain, pore details, wrinkles, and lots of stuff like that. For all the details, the way I did it, it was kind of traditional way. I didn't use any scan data or stuff like that. It was all made from nothing. So if I'm taking this.
That's impressive.
You're
saying you use just alphas?
Yes, exactly. I will do it this way. I will try to smooth it. Smooth this one.
It's looking good.
So basically, using the DAM standard, of course.
Hey now.
Hey, there it is.
There.
About time.
Using the DAM standard 2.
There's the 2.
Where's the 2? Do it again.
It's here. So basically, the Dame Standard 2, it's a very finer, it creates very fine wrinkles. I'm going to increase. But when you cross the wrinkle, it will also create some kind of bulge. It's a very subtle way to use it, but it can create some really nice effect, way better than the regular one do. And if you're just pressing hard enough, it will make some very strong wrinkle like that.
And you're in HD mode right now?
Oh, yes.
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 Yes. Oh, so yes. Basically, for most of the wrinkles,
really nice.
I worked like that. But I also created some maps for the wrinkle, like this one, and I will show you quickly how to do it. Yeah, this kind of stuff I created in ZBrush to get some wrinkle a bit faster. I created this kind of mask that I can put everywhere, like this, and I created another one for the pore details. Like this one. And basically, I worked like this, just putting maps together, switching between maps, trying, it's a bit stronger here. Like this. And using the Dame Standard tool, trying to make everything work together. Oops.
Just a time check for you, Damien.
Oh, yes. Okay.
10 minutes.
So, well, I don't have really much time to show, but the way I did these maps, these custom maps, basically, it's you take a plane, you subdivide it quite a few times, and, you're creating your maps, so I will do something like that. Like that. It's very short on time, so trying to...
You need a little more time? You need another 5 minutes on top of that?
Okay. Just like that, but basically...
You're last. There's no one after you, except giveaways.
Oh, okay. Okay, so just trying to...
Go a little bit.
You can have 3.5 minutes. We'll give it to you.
Oh, fine.
You've contributed
Thank
so
you
much
so
to
much.
The community.
I think we can manage to give you an extra 5 minutes or so.
So yes, basically trying to figure your pattern. What I'm doing when I'm doing this kind of alphas, trying not to put too much details in them, just kind of being very simple, because you're going to use it quite a lot and you're going to overlap the pattern. So I'd rather be simple than with too much details. So when you're happy with your map, you're just going to go to alpha, and grab doc, and I will invert it, because it's not the way I want it. Oh, yes, because the way I'm working, it's you need to put it full screen, and then grab doc, and invert. And now you have your alpha that you can use. So basically, it's like that I created these two alphas. If I can show you what they look like. So this one, I don't know if I can show you. Oh, yeah, this one, and this one. What did I, is there anything I wanted to add? Project Relax. Morph target. No morph target. I won't speak about morph target. But I guess basically for the modeling part, it's all I had to say. I don't know if you have some questions. Oops.
Any questions on the feed there?
Well, there is a question, which might be a good one to leave for the end. Someone really wanted to know the backstory of the Dame Standard Brush. We can't get away from it.
Well, we'll cover that right before we.
Why you created the Dame Standard Brush?
Basically, because it didn't exist at the time. It was when I worked on this brush, because there was only the standard brush, and everybody knows that the standard brush, is kind of very soft, very round brush. And when you're working with with character, for instance, you always need to get some sharp angle at some point. And this kind of curve, it was something that wasn't present at this time. So,
out of necessity, born of necessity.
Yeah, I think you made it around three, didn't you? 3 or 3.1, I don't remember.
I think.
Somewhere around that.
It was in there.
It was in 2007.
Seven.
I know, because it was for a SIGGRAPH presentation I did.
Yeah, and, that was right around three.
It's kind of a long time ago.
Well, I think it's in everyone's palette. But I don't think 100%. There's an artist that's using ZBrush that doesn't use your
brush.
That's
the guy right
thank
there.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's the guy right there.
Your contribution.
Get the camera on that guy. That's the guy right there. There he is.
Things.
The one and only.
Okay.
What an impact.
So, well, I guess I'm done because it was about polypainting after that, but it was very generic use of polypainting.
You could go ahead, show a little
okay.
bit.
Okay. Yeah, so
you're
show
like
it.
The Les Paul of the ZBrush.
Okay,
so go ahead, you invented the
basically, the way I'm working with polypainting, I like to have some basic polypainting even after some basic stage. So basically, even I'm on the blocking stage, I'm always at some polypainting. So polypainting, the way to do it, it's very simple. You just took a standard brush, and instead of using the ZA or Z sub, you're just using the RGB. So basically, you're going on, you pick up a color, and you, oh yes, it's working, but it's very slow. I don't know why it's so. Well, I will do that. Oh yeah, also yes. Well, it's a good stuff. Speaking about poly paint. So basically, yes. What I
and we're saving, and we're saving.
I try to escape, but I won't escape too much because it can crash. I will go there with less resolution. So I'm going to first do some very broad color zone.
People pay
basically,
attention.
I'm using polypaint the same as I'm modeling. It's first doing some very broad color and then going to.
So where are you deciding to put the blue? How are you deciding where to put the blue and put the
basically,
red?
I'm putting the blue where there are some
cavity.
Some cavities, but inside the mesh, inside the body. So where you have some more flesh, and I'm trying to get with more yellowish stuff, where you can see the skull, or where the skull is not very, very far.
So. Yeah, that's great. So you're using the yellow is where the skin's closer to the bone.
Yes.
Where it's blue, where it's actually not as close to the bone.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a bigger gap. And you're using the red.
The red will be where you have a lot of blood,
yep.
so on the finer tissue, on the nose, and stuff like that.
Yep.
So basically, this will be the way to do something very broad. And once I start to have something like that, I will start to blend this together with the tone of my skin. So I will use some alpha to get something more interesting, like this. I will use a spray brush, and I will remove the color. And I will pick this kind of color, for instance. And up, I will maybe. It's not very visible. I will.
What color? You picked the skin tone color?
Oh, I pick it here, but basically it's kind of brownish color.
Yeah.
And yes, I will very softly blend this color here. What I can do from time to time before doing this blending, I can do some, it's working great with this alpha, where is it?
It's pretty cool to see you do that digitally, where you have like your lightest lights and your darkest darks, and then you're just putting in your mid-tone and sort of blurring it together. It's really neat.
Yeah, this goes back to traditional.
All the way back.
Yes,
this goes
exactly.
all the way back to like traditional painting.
Summer Caravaggio is smiling.
It's exactly that. It's looking at the master, painting master, the way they are doing their skin. And it was very lively on their painting, traditional painting. And from this kind of project, I think it's better because it's kind of stylized in the end, but it's actually what I'm looking for. I don't want to take scan data, which will be very realistic skin, but it will lack some personality, it will lack some stylization that I'm looking for this character. So I can add some bit of variation, and after I will blend it a bit more. It's a process when you do and redo most of the stuff.
Yeah, it's a build-up. Yeah,
look at it. See, now it's slowly pushing
Yeah, exactly.
colors.
It's slowly going.
You're creating a subdermal of colors.
Yes,
is
basically.
Pretty much what's happening.
So on this stage, I will stop. Yeah. I will go back to my, just to show you some tips with this. So basically, when you have details and you're working on your poly paint.
Yeah.
That subtlety is what creates that realism. That's a big thing for me. Yeah. Subtle stuff is what makes things pop off the screen, create some realism.
I will
use people. This is a Lisa Needs Braces. Great tipping right here going on right now. For those that know, my Lisa Needs Braces.
Like a master class. I can't believe we're here live doing this on the floor. Look at this.
Okay, so I will use some very different colors to show my points. So basically, when I have this base that I'm just done. I will add some details, and what is great, it's you can get some details from your actual modeling. So here, I don't have my base, but what I can do, it's using the masking features, and the one really useful in this case, it's mask by cavities. Here, it is here. Mask by cavities, using by default. In this case, it's not very interesting, so you have to tweak the setting. I will boost the intensity. So it's starting to become interesting, but I can work with this, but I want something a bit with a bit more transition between each part, so I will play with this and maybe a bit less cavities. Maybe like this. No, we'll try. No, it doesn't work the way I was. That's a bit better. Yes, okay, almost there. Yes, this kind of stuff. So you have to play with the settings, but now I start to have a better transition, and what I can do now, I will hide my mask, because I don't want to see my mask when I'm painting. Mm-hmm. And also what I like to do when I'm poly painting, I'm actually have hotkeys for this kind of setup.
Cool.
It's very simple setup. It's just basically I took some. Where is it? I think it's here. No. Oh, it's here.
You're looking for render.
It's a preview best. No.
Oh, best. Yeah.
Not best. Preview flat and fat. So I just assign some hotkeys to this, so I can just go and switch easily. And now I will. Just work on my paint.
Really neat.
And you can also, what is great, it's to smooth this as long as you do it that. Okay, I'm going to smooth it also to make even a better transition.
Really awesome.
And I can just now invert my mask. I hide it. And I will work on the crease with the same process. Maybe a bit darker here. Smooth it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the nice parts where those blues and the reds are meeting, they're going to make some purple in there too.
Really exquisite. Really nice work.
And that way, in the end, when you're looking with light on everything, you can get some very nice effect, and you can get some very realistic effect, and bring back details together with the color.
That's awesome. You get two thumbs up from me. That's the stuff right there.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Chock full of tips.
That was a, man, a really heavy presentation, a lot of really good features and tips in there.
I really hope, people will enjoy it and that people learn.
You got two guys clapping for you now.
Yeah, absolutely. Are you kidding me?
Well done.
Awesome. The one question that did come through, how are you handling all your HD? Because you were using HD,
yes.
Right?
So on this
for
project.
That project, you used HD.
Yes.
So how did you handle all your HD files? Were you just sending everything to displacement maps and
normal
maps?
Yes, everything to displacement.
Cool.
And so, you're doing a whole face in HD?
Yes.
And the bodies or anything else?
No, only for the faces, because for the body is too much. And actually, I didn't need for the body because the character has clothes, So you don't see the body.
Awesome.
Yeah. And then we did, behind Damien.
Let's do that first before
behind Damien, anywhere. There's some of your models that we've had in this environment that there, wow, there we go, some of the Damien models.
Reach out and touch
me. You printed, you 3D printed both of these,
yes,
didn't you?
Yes, both of them, yes.
Yeah.
Through the power of AR, here we are looking at your
look pieces at
a little closer.
How yeah, do you let's feel take a closer that? Look at these.
Oh, that's exquisite. And Damien, look at that.
Yeah, it's awesome. I can touch it.
Look at it at a large scale. That's awesome stuff. Like, look at that. That's gorgeous.
Really neat.
And you're taking the time to kind of just do a little bit of your details by hand, which I like too. Not letting like a big alpha take control of everything for you. So you guys can really see this now too at a larger scale here within the environment we have here, two of Damien's models.
A lot of attention really to detail. You know, a lot of people have been saying a lot of nice things about the environment. One more tip of the hat to Anna Carolina, our fellow ZBrusher over in Florida, and her team for helping to put this together. Really
awesome.
Looking fantastic, and these are great models.
And for Damien, putting these together too, so we can bring them in the environment.
You got any last words for him before I send him off?
First of all, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
That's what I was waiting. I know
on the way in, you had some bumps in the road.
So. Yes, the road to Los Angeles was pretty long.
Yeah. We're so happy you're able to make it, and I'm sure you're exhausted.
No, it's fine.
Time difference.
Wild horses.
The stress is gone now. I'm done. It's perfect.
We're very happy.
I'm good now.
Have you.
Yes.
And
yes.
Wild horses couldn't keep him away. Damien Kanderley, the creator of the Dame Standard brush. Now we know it's Dame.
Now we know.
Dame Standard
now
1.
Now we know.
And Dame Standard 2.
And I know people were sharing your Dame Standard 2 also in the chat, so people get a hold of that.
You're going to give away some more things.
I have things to give away.
So before we do that, let's say goodbye proper. I want to thank you so much for being here with us. Myself.
Thank you very much.
And Paul Gabory on behalf of the Maxon ZBrush team.
Thank you so much.
Behind the cameras, thanks so much. And we'll be right back with some prize giveaways, okay? Thank you.